Thank you. Thank you so much. And everybody hear me okay? Now, you want to know what really sucks? I mean, it does. But what sucks is that I have to come up here after this Dr. George guy. And then tonight you get Dr. Walter Williams. So here you have a guy that used to jump out of airplanes for, you know, a good part of his Army career. And, you know, I saw some of those questions you were asking Dr. George. Don't ask me some of those questions, okay? just don't. This thing is being recorded. And my daughters may see this, and they may come to believe that their dad really is stupid, okay? But I cannot think of a better place to be than to speaking before the future of the United States of America, okay? I'm kind of getting up there in age. I'm 58. But what I want to do is to make sure that we turn over a better America, better than what my father and my mother turned over to me, for each and every one of you. Because if this country, this constitutional republic, is to continue on for another 243 years, it's going to be you guys that ensure that. You're the linchpin. And so I want to start off by reading a little something to you. And I just want to have a short conversation. They told me I got, 42:30. I got 42 minutes and 30 seconds. If you think I'm going to stand up here and talk for 42 minutes and 30 seconds, you are out of your mind. See? What I want to do is talk about how critical you are for the future of this country for about 15, 20 minutes. And then the rest of the time, you guys get to ask me whatever question you want. Just don't go asking me any of these PhD-level questions, okay? All right, let me read you a quote. And the great thing I like about these is you can just pull something up, and it's right there. Commandancy of the Alamo, Bear, February the 24th, 1836. To the people of Texas and all Americans in the world, fellow citizens and compatriots, I am besieged by 1,000 or more of the Mexicans under Santa Anna. I have sustained a continual bombardment and cannonade for 24 hours and have not lost a man. The enemy has demanded a surrender at discretion. Otherwise, the garrison are to be put to the sword if the fort is taken. I have answered the demand with a cannon shot. And our flag still waves proudly from the walls. I shall never surrender or retreat. Then I call on you in the name of liberty, of patriotism, and everything dear to the American character to come to our aid with all dispatch. The enemy is receiving reinforcements daily and will no doubt increase to 3,000 or 4,000 in 4 or 5 days. If this call is neglected, I am determined to sustain myself as long as possible and die like a soldier who never forgets what is due to his own honor and that of his country. Victory or death. William Barrett Travis, Lieutenant Colonel, Commandant. That was the letter that was written, given to a young man by the name of Juan Seguin, and delivered to Sam Houston. You all know the story about the Alamo. 13 days, 185 men stood there. That's where, when I went to the University of Tennessee, we earned our nickname as the Volunteers. But the thing that I want you to understand is that William Barrett Travis, when he wrote that incredible letter, was only 26 years of age. Same age as my daughter is right now, the oldest. My youngest daughter just graduated college last Saturday from Florida International University. She's 22. I want you to have that exact same character, that exact same spirit, that exact same desire to stand and fight. Because when I look at where you are on these college campuses and university campuses all across the United States of America, it may seem like you are surrounded. It may seem like you have no hope whatsoever. It may seem like a desperate situation, but you've got to make a stand if you truly believe in this constitutional republic. See, the great thing about soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, Coast Guardsmen is that we don't take an oath to a political party. We don't take an oath to an individual. We take an oath to that thing which embodies us all as the American people, our rule of law. When we stand up, as I did on 31 July 1982, and say, I, state your full name, Alan Bernard West, will support and defend the Constitution of the United States of America against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, that I take this obligation freely without any purpose of evasion or mental reservation, so help me God. My dad took that oath. My older brother took that oath. My father-in-law, who is buried right across the Potomac River in Arlington National Cemetery, took that oath. My nephew, who is serving right now as a major in the Army, took that oath. Each and every one of you need to find that thing that gives you the courage, that gives you the inspiration to stand up and fight on these college campuses. We saw what happened to the young man at the University of California in Berkeley. We saw what happened to the young man in Portland, Oregon, who was attacked. We know what Antifa is doing. And I got to tell you something. You want me to understand how stupid these socialists are? They call themselves anti-fascists, but yet they're going out and attacking people to keep them from being able to speak freely. What the hell are they learning in school? That's a failure of our education system, folks. But the thing is this, and I just recently wrote about it. Anyone here from the University of Texas, Austin? Anybody here from Texas? All right, here we go. All right, I know. Giggum. All right. The commandant there at Texas A&M, he and I served on active duty together, Brigadier General Ramirez. But so I know that what I'm about to say about the University of Texas, Austin, is going to give these Aggies just a whole lot of joyous celebration, I know. TU, not UT. But how many of you all have heard about the Autonomous Student Network? Okay? This is a group in Austin, Texas, that just publicly came out and said to any incoming freshman that signs up for the Young Conservatives of Texas or Turning Point USA or any conservative organization that they're going to do this thing called doxing. And that they're keeping a list. See, this is why you're so important. Because you're on the front lines. You're on the tip of the spear of an ideological battleground in the United States of America. Because we all know that supposedly we have these three branches of government. The executive branch, the legislative branch, the judicial branch. But when you think about the progressive socialist left, they don't believe in three branches of government, they believe in three branches of rule. It is the media, it is the judiciary, and it's academia. And they're going to do everything they possibly can to have a totalitarian ideological domination on our college and university campuses. And the only way that's going to fail is because of you. Because of you, because of you, because all of you all here. And that's why we need you. Even as William Barrett Travis wrote that letter, surrounded by 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, but he held on because he said it was about victory or death. How many folks here watched the debate last night? How many folks took Pepto-Bismol, Maalox, or something to... But we must pay attention to the other side. We must see what they are professing. And what I wrote about this morning, I said, you know, did you all notice how absolutely unhappy they were? I did not see anybody cracking a joke, no humor, no levity, no nothing. They were all just filled with so much angst. Why would we want to follow a philosophy of government, of governance, that does not make the people professing it happy? When you think about young people in this generation, and the generation of the selfie and, you know, me and all these type of things, why would anybody in this current generation follow these control freaks? That's what they are. They seek to control every single aspect of your life. That's all you heard last night. That's all you're going to hear tonight. Are people that are saying that you, young people, you don't have the ability, you don't have the competence, you don't even have the right to go out and pursue your happiness. See, it comes down to two choices, and I always love sharing this with people. You have the equality of opportunity on one side that says a kid like me, born in a black-only hospital in Atlanta, Georgia in 1961, could rise up and command a field artillery battalion in combat and become a member of the United States House of Representatives. In 1961, when I was born, blacks could not go on the beach at Fort Lauderdale. As a matter of fact, you can go back and read, they had this thing called a wade-in later on in the summer, 1961. 50 years later, I was sworn in as a congressional representative that included Fort Lauderdale Beach. That's the power. That's the power of classical liberalism, which is today's constitutional conservatism. If you have not gone out and read John Locke's Second Treatise of Government, when John Locke talked about the natural rights that we have, that our inalienable rights are endowed to us from our Creator of life, liberty, and property, that's what we're fighting for now. Because when you listen to the people last night and the people tonight, they're going to tell you that those supposedly inalienable rights that you have and constitutional rights that you have, they don't matter. Because to the left, they have all of a sudden redefined rights as their ideological agenda. And if there is a constitutional right, an inalienable right that violates their ideological agenda, their ideological rights, it means nothing. Because for them, it is not about the equality of opportunity that each and every one of us has. No matter where you are born, no matter where you come from. For them, it's about an equality of outcomes. I applaud President Trump for bringing to light the failure of progressive socialism in all of these inner cities across the United States of America, in Baltimore, and here in Washington, D.C., in Atlanta, Dallas, wherever you go, where they control things. You do see that despair. Now, who wants to sign up to be a part of that? It's a clear-cut choice, young people. You can choose to be a victor or you can be a victim. And what they want are victims. Because in having victims, then you have to become dependent upon them. They become the ones that grant you your buy or your leave or this or that. Because you don't have the innate ability to go out there and achieve the American dream. And I will not allow this generation that includes my two daughters to be shorted of the American dream. That a father like mine, born in 1920 in South Alabama, and a mother like mine, born in 1931 in South Georgia, enable me to have so that I can be standing here before you all. This is worth the fight. And when they call you names, there's only one reason why they're calling you names, to shut you up. Racism and racist means nothing other than the fact it's a political hammer to get you to self-censor. I mean, think about it. In 1 week, at the beginning of the week, Speaker of the House Nancy Pelosi called President Trump a racist because he wanted to put the citizenship question back in the census, and the citizenship question had already been in the census before 2010. It had nothing to do with being racist. But in the same week, the little suicide squad of those four little they turned on Nancy Pelosi and called her a racist because she was not happy with the way that they were conducting themselves within the Democrat caucus. We're just throwing that word out there for no reason. The president brings out something that is a clear and present threat and danger in our inner city communities. The decimation of the family, the lack of quality education opportunities, the dearth of small business entrepreneurship and growth. And they call him a racist for that. Because they just want you to not say anything at all. If there's one message I can tell you, is you got to fight. You got to get dogfighting mad. And as I used to tell my soldiers before they went out on a mission, you either get to fighting or you get to dying. And if you don't stand and fight, then what will you see lost? It's the longest running constitutional republic that the world has ever known. And I will tell you that my generation has not done a good job setting you guys up for success. When I think about how stupid we were when we looked out at kids on the little league fields, the soccer fields, and the baseball fields, and we were upset because little Johnny and little Jane were sitting on the bench, didn't get to play. Now see, in my day, my mommy and daddy would have said, boy, you need to practice harder, because you're embarrassing me sitting there on the bench, because everyone knows that's my boy. But what did we do? We came up with this silly little thing called a participation trophy. And now the culture of the participation trophy has continued on into these generations, and now they're sitting back waiting for someone to give them something, and that's exactly how you play into the hands of the other side. You claim a victim mentality. Don't be a victim. When you go back on these college campuses and universities, don't think that you have to sit in a class where someone writes in their syllabus, if you don't agree with my perspective or my worldview, it will adversely affect your grade. You take that syllabus and you get it out there to some of these organizations like GAF. You take that syllabus and give it to me. And I'll have fun with that professor. But I don't ever want you to think. I don't ever want you to think that you have to be victimized by these campus administrations, these professors, or your peers. Because if they truly believed in what they said they believed in, if they truly thought that they could win any type of debate, then why did they try to shut you down? Why did they not allow any type of opposing voice to come on these campuses? Because they know what ends up happening. And that's the strength of this organization. Because old heads, old gray heads like me, we need to come on these campuses and we need to do the fight with you. We shouldn't leave you there by yourselves. And the other thing I want you to do is start thinking about, once you get out of college or university, how you can go out and have an impact. I will tell you that we have not done a good job with our young conservatives in propping them up and getting them into elected positions. I think that you all are the generation that should be out there running for city council. You all are the generation that should be out there running for school board. You all are the generations that should be out there being in county commission seats. And then we need to start developing you guys to come up through that pipeline, to be the next generation of state house members, state senators, because that's what they do in baseball with a farm team system. And that's how we want to, and that's how we must start preparing you all to get out there and be ready to play in the major leagues. But as I close, because I'm at 25-14. I want you to fight. I want you to have that exact same spirit of William Barrett Travis. I want you to have the exact same spirit of so many of our forefathers and foremothers, that they didn't sit back and wait for their time. They had it within their hearts. They knew what freedom meant. They knew what liberty stood for. And they said, I'll make my own stand. I want you to think about how in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8, when Isaiah stood before the host of the Lord, and they said, whom shall we send? Who will go for us? I want each and every one of you to stand up and say, here am I. Send me. Travis showed us that you're not too young. The most decorated soldier in World War II was a young man by the name of Audie Murphy out of Texas. He wasn't too young to go and fight for liberty and freedom against Nazism and Italian fascism. You're not too young to be on this battlefield and make a stand. So when you leave out of here and you go back to your college campuses and universities, you need to have a renewed spirit. You need to walk through that valley of the quote-unquote shadow of death. And you should not fear any of the evil of progressive socialism. You ever notice something? In all these debates, nobody has ever asked them about Venezuela. You think they're going to ask them about it tonight? You know why? Because they know that's exactly how it always ends. And that's why you can stand on the side of victory. That's why you can be a victor. And do not allow them to make you a victim. So with that being said, what are your questions? All right, we'll alternate either side. Young lady, please give me your name and where you're from.
Hi, my name is Rachel Schultz, and I'm from the College of Lake County in Grays Lake, Illinois.
All right, Rachel.
The Chicago area where I'm from is like decimated by like progressives being in charge for way too long.
Yep.
And I wondered what we can do to remind like young, especially young Black Americans, how their grandparents' generation won civil rights. Like, how can we bring that back? And also, how can we explain to them that the Democratic Party has never been for them?
Well, I think that's one of the key parts about history. You know, I've been living in Texas now for the past 5 years. I wasn't born there, but I got there as fast as I could. They know what I'm talking about. Do you know who founded the Republican Party of Texas on July the 4th of 1867? 150 blacks. 150 blacks founded the Republican Party of Texas. And the fact that you very astute young people did not know that shows us that we don't know our history. 13th, 14th, 15th Amendments, Republicans. The Democrat Party has been responsible for creating two domestic terrorist organizations, the Ku Klux Klan and Antifa. You always hear the left talk about how they hate white supremacists, racists, and the Klan. Well, then explain to me why an organization that was founded by a white supremacist, racist, and a person that spoke to Klan meetings by the name of Margaret Sanger, Planned Parenthood is located, 70% of their clinics, in minority communities. Do you know that thanks to Planned Parenthood, we're at 20 million murdered black babies? Now, any other case, that would be called a genocide, right? But I don't think you're going to hear Spartacus Booker, Kami Harris, or any of these other chuckle brains talk about that, okay? But that's what we must do. In 1961, when I was born, two-parent household in the black community was between 75 and 77%. Today it's 23 to 24%. Trace it back to the Great Society programs of Lyndon Johnson. So these are the type of facts that you have on your side. And when you're in a gathering like this, you guys, here's a homework assignment. I want you to develop a fact sheet. I want you to, you know, pull out your little 3x5 cards. Leaders never leave home without their 3x5 cards. And I want you to be armed with the facts so that when you come up in front of these, you know, mindless lemmings and these useful idiots, okay, you can just whip out your 3x5 cards and say, did you know? Did you know? Did you know? And then watch them shut up. You know, no one is talking about... I was speaking at Northwestern University, and maybe y'all can go back and Google it. It was a YAF event, and a young black female came up and started yapping her mouth about, you know, how the president is racist and he hates black people. I said, are you stupid or what? You live right here in Chicago, and the greatest amount of black-on-black crime, I mean, are you concerned about that? That's why I think that little video has a lot of hits. You have to just go at them. And Rachel, I'm going to tell you something. You show me anywhere in military history that a battle has ever been won on defense, I'll take you out to Ruth Chris and I'll buy you the biggest steak you ever wanted, okay? Because there's never been a battle won on defense. Even if you are successful in defending, you must counterattack. So I want you all to go on the offense. You don't need to defend classical liberalism. You don't need to defend constitutional conservatism. That's what made this the greatest nation that the world has ever known.
Hi, I'm James Wall from the University of South Florida, and my question is kind of similar, but I think conservatives champion more than anyone that you can come from any background, any race, any orientation, and be successful. And so, you know, what would you respond to the claims that white supremacy is on the rise in the United States and as well as the conservative movement?
Well, I don't think white supremacy is on the rise. And once again, you know, it's so funny when I hear the Democrats talk about reparations. You know, the people that should be paying reparations is the Democrat Party. You know, everything about slavery, segregation, it was them. I mean, Jim Crow, poll taxes, literacy tests, lynchings, all of these things, that came from the Democrat Party. And so I don't see white supremacy on the rise. And if white supremacy is on the rise, it's because they gave birth to it in the very first place. And the very reason. You know something? No one gets upset when a bunch of little white progressive socialists call me an Uncle Tom, an Oreo, a sellout, a house N-word, a white man's porch monkey. I mean, that's okay for them. And I think that's where we got to draw the line. You know, we don't see people in these collective groups, which is how they see people, and try to pit them against each other. We just see Americans. We just see people that want to live and achieve this dream here. So again, don't get drawn down into them putting you on the defense and making you defend the fact that you're a conservative. Okay, the black community, how many people here have ever read Up From Slavery, the autobiography of Booker T. Washington? Okay, that's another homework assignment. It's not that very long, okay? But Booker T. Washington was without a doubt the first black conservative. And his principles still reign true today. Education, entrepreneurship, and self-reliance. Now ask them, is that what they stand for? Never be on the heels. Always put them back on their heels. That's the thing that I will tell you. So no, I don't see this white supremacy on the rise. And tearing down statues, that's what the Taliban did in Afghanistan. That's what ISIS did in Palmyra, Syria. And why are they tearing down statues? Because they don't want us to know their history. Because once we know their history, we will find them quite repulsive. So this revisionist history, you know, history exists for us to learn from. And I think that is key also.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hello, Mr. Allen. First off, thank you for coming and thank you for your service.
Well, they told me I had to be here. I thank you all for being here.
My question is very similar. How does reparations tie in with the Democrats' attempt to control?
It's very simple. And first of all, I will tell you, anyone that comes up to me and starts talking about reparations, it's offensive. It's condescending. But you got to understand what they're truly trying to do. They're trying to continue to perpetuate a slave mentality. They're trying to continue to perpetuate a victim mentality. Folks here from Texas know about Juneteenth. That was the day that the blacks out in Texas found out that they were liberated. On Juneteenth of this year, in the House of Representatives, they were holding hearings about reparations. Now, Juneteenth was all about emancipation, freedom, liberty, breaking the chains of bondage. And here you got these jackasses, and that's what they are. They're the party of the jackass. I'm sorry. I don't care, if, you know. But that's what they are. I told y'all I used to jump out of airplanes and shoot at bad guys. I'm not that. You know. But here they are still promoting a slave mentality. Income inequality. I mean, you'll hear that tonight from, you know, Senator Spartacus. Some of us are tall. Some of us are short. Some of us have great artistic talents. I have no artistic talents whatsoever. I can't sing. I can't dance. I can't draw. Okay? I went to school with guys like Willie Gault, Reggie White, Bill Bates, Dale Ellis. All of them went on to win Super Bowl rings. Prolific NBA three-point shooters. We are all born unequal. But how is it that these people think that they have the power to be able to make us all equal? They got a really warped God complex. And that is what we must understand. One of y'all asked a question earlier today about the transgenderism thing, the gender dysphoria thing. The left wants to undermine the omnipotence and the sovereignty of God, big G God. Why? Because if God could not figure out two genders, because what, we're up to 73 now? I'm glad I don't take biology now. I would definitely fail. But if he couldn't figure that out, then how can he figure out this whole inalienable rights thing? And so when I look at the left and who they are and what they're doing, all they want to do is collectively subjugate us to their will, to their ideology, to their totalitarianism, to their tyranny. And they will do everything possible to destroy the black community, the Hispanic community, any community, for their own political and electoral gain. And so that's why I think anyone that says, you know, as Cardinal Thomas Dolan said when they had this thing about reparations, tell me how much of a check I need to write to Oprah Winfrey. That's how stupid this is.
Thank you.
And look, in full disclosure, the symbol of the Democrat Party is a jackass.
Hey, Lieutenant West. My name is Nathan Bechet from Loyola Marymount.
See?
I was wondering how...
That's Nancy Pelosi.
I was wondering how...
Now, how come that didn't happen for Dr. George?
Sorry.
That's right, racist construction guys. Yeah. All right, come on.
Sorry. I was wondering how a higher up like you in the military would deal with the Iran crisis and nuclear threats.
This is funny. Okay, being in the military, how would I deal with the Iran crisis and their nuclear threat? Will someone get them to stop? Okay? I bet it won't happen for Dr. Williams either. But when you look at Iran, we are talking about the number one state sponsor of Islamic terrorism. We're talking about a country that has really and truthfully been at war with the... They're cutting into my time. Let's see if we can get them to stop. At least you all didn't say drill, baby, drill. When you talk about Iran, you know, back in 1979, we had the hostage crisis. In 1983, they sponsored Hezbollah, and you had the Beirut barracks bomb. It killed 234. Even when I was over in Iraq, there's a thing called the explosive force penetrator. It's a real lethal improvised explosive device. And that's what they were using, and it created 18 to 20% of the deaths and casualties of our soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines in Iraq. So for us to believe that we can sit down and have a conversation and be rational and reasonable with people that are part of a theocratic political structure. I mean, Iran, their belief is that, how many folks have ever heard about the 12th Imam, the Mahdi? In order for that 12th Imam to come back, there has to be an apocalyptic event. And so that's why they are pursuing this nuclear technology. And even with the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, the Iranian nuclear agreement, it just pushed their breakout time a little bit later. They were still going to be able to continue to pursue and get a weapon and a device, and they're going to use it. So the great thing about having President Trump in there saying that this was a stupid thing and we should not be sending pallets of cash to the number one state sponsor of Islamic terrorism, you now have Hezbollah standing out on street corners begging for money. And that's a good thing. So when I looked at everyone last night talking about how they would sit down and try to have a conversation with Iran and how the nuclear agreement, we should still be in it, they can't be president because they don't understand the nature of the enemy. Hello back.
I'm Connor Hanks from UC Santa Barbara.
I've been there.
Very cool. I don't say a lot of things that you already know, but I just want to let you know you are such a man, like Jesus. But you briefly touched on Venezuela, and I've paid attention to that, and certainly I'm sure many of us know about the dearming of the public and the institution of an oppressive dictatorship over there. And although it's a dark thought to think about, I think it's something that we should think about here in our country, especially with the push for the dearmament of our public, is have you ever thought about where we should draw a line in the sand, where we should learn from the Venezuelan people and see when we should stop and actively prevent our government from dearming us? And particularly, like, when do we stop appeasing the government with our complacency?
Well, I think that Venezuela should be a cause for the entire international community. When we see the fact that there are people going to sewers to try to get drinking water, when we see that, you know, people that are starving on the streets, people that are being run over by military vehicles, you know, when we say never again for the Holocaust, never again should mean that we should never see any socialist dictatorship, you know, really try to kill and trounce its own people. Now, I don't think that the United States of America has to step up and take the lead role, but I think that it's important that we pull together a coalition in this hemisphere. You know, the Monroe Doctrine is still in place. And when you think about China, when you think about Iran, when you think about Russia and some of these other players that are coming into our hemisphere and what they're doing, see, they're lucky that I couldn't bring my guns up here. Okay, I'm just kidding, all right? I'm not gonna shoot anybody. It's just a, what do you call it, metaphorical thing, okay? But when we look at what is happening in Venezuela, that says a lot about who we are as the United States of America. If we're gonna sit back and allow this to happen, I mean, you can hop a plane from Washington, D.C. and be in Venezuela in, what, 4 hours? I mean, we should not have something like this happening today in modern society. And again, the fact that we have 20 presidential candidates that have been completely silent on that issue, that tells me that they're complicit. And if they had the opportunity, they'd do the exact same thing here in the United States of America. So we've already crossed, to me, a red line or a line of sand or whatever, to allow such a dictatorship to happen. You know, remember when Hugo Chavez came to power? You had Oliver Stone running down there, you had Sean Penn running down there, Harry Belafonte, Danny Glover. When was the last time you seen any of these Hollywood elites run down to Venezuela? That's what we need to do and start challenging these people, because that's how socialism ends up. So
hopefully I responded to your question.
Thank you.
God bless you.
How you doing, Mr. West?
I'm doing good. If I was any better, I'd be you.
My name is Justin Corner from Broward County, Florida.
Hey!
I love your work. Love you.
Where,
love
where
your
do you
story.
Live in Broward County?
Deerfield Beach, Florida.
You know, I taught high school at Deerfield Beach when I first retired.
What year?
Are you trying to age me out, man? ageism here. I taught there 2004 to 2005. I coached track there, and you know, teaching at Deerfield Beach was such an enjoyable experience. I volunteered to go back to Afghanistan. No, I'm just kidding. Give it up.
So in an interview in 2017, you stated, or you gave Trump a C for his first 8 months in office. I was just wondering, with almost 4 years under Trump's belt coming to a close, what would you give him now?
If you go back, I did an interview with Mark Levin, and he asked me the exact same question earlier this year, and I told him that you have to bifurcate the president on policy and everything. I give him an A+. Everything, you know, our economy, our national security, our energy security, it's all going in the right direction. It cannot be debated. Now, are there some times that I wish he would put down that little, you know, Twitter toy? Yeah, because, you know, I think as the president of the United States of America, you don't need to punch down. If you're going to punch, you punch out to other world leaders. However, I will tell you this. What President Donald Trump has done, no other Republican has ever shown the left that they're willing to stand toe-to-toe and fight them. And that is something he has to get kudos for. And he has completely drawn these people out of their little closet. And they're now telling us exactly who they are, what they stand for, and what they believe in. So that I thank him for. So again, I would say, you know, with his, you know, tweets and personality, sometimes I give him, you know, B-, but with the policies, A+. And he's grown into this position. He really has grown into it.
Please come back to Florida.
All right, I'm down to 150 thanks to the drill. Hey, can I get 5 minutes back? All right, so I'll try to finish up, but I'll be here for a while. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Courage. I'm from Texas. I go to the University of Michigan.
You from Texas?
Yes.
And you go to the University of Michigan. Do you know about Kathy Zhu? You heard about her?
Yes, yes.
University of Michigan student?
Yes.
Don't go to the University of Michigan. No, I'm just kidding.
Of course.
World Hijab Day.
So I've seen your stuff on radical Islam, and I wanted to ask you, do you think the main problem with jihadists are is the religion or Islamism? Like, do you think it's more of a problem of Islam in general, or Islamism, meaning that they seek an Islamic state?
Well, it is. It's all, you know, captured there in the Quran and the Hadith, which are the traditions of Muhammad. You know, have you ever read the Muslim Brotherhood's explanatory memorandum, their strategic memorandum? You know, this is a document that was written just right across the Potomac in 1991 by a guy by the name of Muhammad Akram. It was discovered in an FBI raid in 2004 in the basement of a home. And it's open source intel. And I want you to read that. That's another homework assignment. Read the strategic memorandum of the Muslim Brotherhood in the United States of America. And they lay out their plan. And when you listen to a person like President Erdogan of Turkey, who once said there is no moderate Islam and other Islam, it's just Islam. So I just kind of have to tell you, you just got to take your opposition for their own word. And if you, I don't have the time to do it, but if you go back and study from 610 through 628 AD on to 632, you will see exactly all of those different phases of Islam, the peaceful phase, which was just 12 years, then the Medina phase, which was 622 to 628, when you can see the corresponding verses of the Quran become more violent, and then, of course, when Muhammad came back to Mecca, and he took it, and, you know, 3,000.
So is the religion or the...
It's rooted in there. It is rooted in there, those verses. And I also want to tell you, understand the Arabic term Naqish. Naqish translated means abrogation. And what that means through Islamic jurisprudence is that the later versions of the Quran supersede the previous versions of the Quran. But they're still all the words of Allah. And so we have to understand this, and we have to just say, look, this is not a perversion. This is part of what is in the book that you call the Quran. And so that you have people that are standing up and they are using the Quran to enact these different types of violence. Now, I've been to Iraq, I've been to Afghanistan, I've been all over the Middle East. I have helped some of my former interpreters and translators come to the United States of America because they wanted a better way of life. But I'm not going to sit here and play a politically correct game just to make people feel good about themselves when I see my country and freedom and liberty all across the world at stake. But I will tell you, you got to study, you got to understand, and then you will be able to articulate this. It's not about Muslims, but it is about a very, very violent aspect that has become rooted and has turned what started out to be a peace religion into a totalitarian, theocratic political ideology.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Caden Core. I'm from California.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I know.
You're welcome to come to Texas as long as you're a conservative.
Okay, yeah. So, by the way, I don't think you forgot your guns. You brought them.
Hey, man, don't you know, you know, edit that out of the tape. No, I'm good.
So
implants, actually.
In California, I just graduated, and people in California always use the phrase, I can risk my life for my country, but I can't drink or smoke. And people always talk about college, you know, ways to find college for free. And so I wanted to ask you how was your military experience, and how did it help shape your life after your service?
Everything about my military experience helped to shape me, to include my dad's military service. My dad sat me down at the age of 15 on the steps of our home, 651 Kennesaw Avenue. And here's a man that went to fight for this country in World War II when this country did not afford him all the rights and privileges it did others. And he said, there's no greater honor than to wear the uniform of the United States of America. And he said to me, I want you to be the first officer in our family, because he was a corporal and my older brother was a Lance Corporal. So the military taught me about service, sacrifice, and commitment. It taught me about that there's something that is a higher calling than just yourself, that you have to be willing to be committed to and then convicted and stand by that even when the winds may blow a different direction. It taught me the discipline. And I can tell you one of the things that upset me about being up here in Congress is that in the military, we don't leave until the job's done. It's all about mission accomplishment. Where are the folks, your elected federal representatives right now? They're home. The reason why they started a recess in Washington, D.C. in August, because it's the hottest month up here in Washington, D.C., because Washington, D.C. is actually built on a swamp. They got air conditioning now. There's no reason they have to go home. And so there are many things that if you are committed to this country, that they will be up here working on. 45 to 50 years ago, over 70% of the members of the House and Senate here in Washington, D.C. had done what? They served in the military. Today, that number is down to about 16-17%. And I think you can see the corresponding lack of commitment to this country. The fact that we have a person that is sitting, serving in the United States House of Representatives that would demonize men and women in uniform, that will refer to 9/11, the Pearl Harbor of, you know, modern day generations, as some people did something, that's reprehensible to me.
Thank you.
Okay. You get the last word, and I'm going to still be around.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you for coming to speak to us today. My name is Katrina Fee, and I go to the Catholic University of America. And my question is that I've seen the erosion of respect for our service members and armed forces in my generation today, and I'm wondering why you think that is and how we can fix that.
Well, the great question. How many folks here have ever seen the movie Saving Private Ryan? Yeah. There's an interesting vignette, the interesting segment of that movie, which I think is the real definition of that movie, is when Tom Hanks' character, I forget the captain's name, Captain Miller has been shot, and because they were defending the bridge over the Murderette River. And he calls Matt Damon's character, Private Ryan, over to him. And as Private Ryan leans down as he's bleeding out, he says two words: earn this. Earn this. And what was it he was talking about? Earn the commitment of that squad of Rangers that went through enemy territory to find you so that you could have a better life, that you could survive this. And then, of course, you fast forward to, you know, older Ryan standing before Captain Miller's gravesite, and he says to his wife, tell me that I was a good man. Tell me that I lived a good life. See, it's one thing to come up to the men and women that you see in uniform at the airports or whatever and say thank you for your service. But I want you to think about, are you earning their service? Are you earning that sacrifice? I mean, somewhere right now, there's an 18, 19, 20-year-old, young man, young woman, standing on freedom's ramparts that you can be here right now. They don't want you to pat them on the back. You don't have to say thank you, but they want you to earn it. And I think for whatever reason, we have lost that idea here in the United States of America. Heroes are not the people that throw a ball, hit a baseball, catch a ball, run fast. Heroes are the people that now allow you to sit here today. God bless you all. Thank you.